It's May 7th, 2020. This is Rock. You know, something you can pretty much bank on the entire Iranian global community agreeing upon is the need for unity. There are big challenges and we're stronger together. Strength in numbers, speaking with a common voice, hamamun baham, solidarity. The only thing is, we all disagree on how to achieve unity. In fact, it's no secret to anyone in the diaspora that we're actually not unified at all. The divisions can run as wide as the miles that separate us across the globe. Today, one of the best-known academic voices in the diaspora on post-revolutionary Iran joins me for an entire episode to discuss the roots and reality of our Iranian disunity. I'm Gian Gomeshi. This is Rook. Okay, welcome to episode number 7 of Rook. I have both, I have Shaya, as he always is, Groovy Shaya, here, you know, but I have Reza as well on the other side of the glass, making a return appearance. Reza and Shaya are here. Hello, guys.
Hello, Gian. Hello.
Sara is also nearby, but socially distanced away from the studio because we can't fit too many people here who can and also stay 6 feet apart. And Reza, you muscled your way in here, and Sara has to stay.
I know. She's not happy about it.
Maybe we can bring her in for Letters of the Week. She does the responding to some of the social media stuff. She also does some of our graphics. I have to mention this. It's not. I won't do it in Letters of the Week, or maybe I should. But I got a couple of letters. You know how you said, see, you made me feel bad. In the last episode, Shaya, I said, Omidvar hastam ke khub hastin. And then you corrected me, or you supposedly corrected me, and said, Omidvar hastam, I should say, Omidvar hastam ke khub bashin, right? And because I'm insecure about my Farsi fluency, which, by the way, is Ali. I just accepted. Like, I was just like, okay, you must be right. And then I started hearing from people saying, actually, what I said isn't incorrect. Go on the mic. Sorry. Yeah.
Actually, I told you that wasn't wrong, but it's more common that we are, because Omidvara means you.
I'm hopeful.
Yes, I'm hopeful. And we use mozare eltezami if I want to
God,
say.
God, he's getting grammatical
now
right now.
He's showing off now. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's more common that we say Omidvar hastam khub bashin.
But actually,
ولی
به من گفتن که اگر بگی امیدوار هستم که خوب هستین, it's actually almost more formal. It's actually it's proper. To say
be
that
honest
way.
With you, I've never heard the word. But that's correct.
Okay, let's just humor him.
Yeah. Today we... so anyway, maybe I can actually read those letters later on in this program. Today we also... we have this, our Thursday feature, Letters of the Week. I speak about that as if it's some produced feature. It's really reading two things that are that somebody said on YouTube, you know, but or whatever. But hey, you know, we're building this. So I want to also mention a couple of things. Our website will be up soon.
Yay!
I like that even you guys are laughing about that, as if that's a. If you're, I don't really know when our website will be up. But if you like what you're hearing, you can subscribe on YouTube. Or to our audio podcast. If you like the podcast format where it tells you when there's a new episode, you can go on iTunes. And if you're not already listening to us on iTunes, and follow us there, the Apple Store or on SoundCloud or Spotify. I also want to mention to next week, we have a couple of exciting guests, two well-known actors, actresses of Iranian descent. One currently well-known for appearing in Bollywood, the other for appearing in Hollywood. So we'll be joined by both next week, going from Bollywood to Hollywood via the Persian diaspora. So stay tuned for that next Monday. But right now, today's featured guest. So as we've already made it a tradition on this program of sorts, we see a real global community when it comes to the Iranian diaspora, and we want to provide some kind of connective tissue with Rok. But the truth is, there are great intra-community divisions that are impossible for any of us to miss. In fact, some may say the rift within the Iranian diaspora is greater than ever. So, for example, you're either in the pro-sanctions, pro-Trump, even pro-military action against Iran camp, or you're, say, considered an agent of the Islamic Republic, a sleeper agent, or a regime apologist. And at the far ends of opinion, non-compliance on either side, of course, is not tolerated. Moderates or people who don't fall into either camp can be targeted by smear campaigns and character assassination by both camps. So what has brought us to this point, and is there any going back? My guest today is an internationally recognized expert on Iran and Middle Eastern politics. Dr. Mehrzad Borujerdi is the director of Virginia Tech School of Public and International Affairs. He's written and contributed to a number of books on Iranian society and politics, including Iranian Intellectuals and the West, The Tormented Triumph of Nativism, and Post-Revolutionary Iran, A Political Handbook. Professor Borujerdi is a past president of the International Society for Iranian Studies and the founding director of the Middle Eastern Studies program at Syracuse University. In addition to more than 30 journal articles and book chapters in English and Persian, he's also the editor of Mirror for the Muslim Prince, Islam and the Theory of Statecraft. Professor Mehrzad Borujerdi joins me from Virginia today. Hello, Professor.
Hello, and thank you for having me on the program.
Thank you so much for doing this. I mean, before anything else, how are you keeping safe from COVID, the pandemic, and what implications has it had for you as an academic?
Yes, so I'm staying home and really, I guess, working from my Zoom bunker since I am have an administrative role at Virginia Tech. This, of course, entails a lot of meetings with faculty and other administrators. So staying put and connecting with folks through Zoom is the way I'm handling my business these days.
All right. Well, I'm glad that you're safe and understandably Zooming your way through this. I want to get to the divisions in our diaspora, but first let me ask just a couple of questions about Iranian and American relations, because I know that's somewhat your wheelhouse. And to be specific, it's been an historic time of enmity, it seems, between the two nations. And I was thinking about you coming on this show and thinking many times collective humanitarian disasters have had a healing effect on international tensions. Like I think a relatively recent example was the 2003 BAM earthquake, which brought in volunteers and aid organizations from far and wide, including a large team from the United States. And in this recent pandemic tragedy, when Iran became the regional epicenter of the coronavirus, neighboring foes such as the UAE and Kuwait, not to mention, say, Japan and France, sent generous aid consignments. No such overture from the United States. So is this ongoing animosity simply about the Trump administration and the saber rattling that we all know about, or is there something deeper going on here?
No, I believe it's really much deeper than that. I mean, if you look at the turbulent state of U.S.-Iranian relations, we need to go back, of course, to 40 years, 41 years ago, during which time we have seen 7 American presidents and 6 Iranian presidents at the helm. And of course, these two countries have not had any diplomatic relations with one another since April of 1980, realistically speaking. And unfortunately, in the absence of this real face-to-face relationship, what we have had has been a great deal of what I call sort of inflated rhetoric by both sides, frankly. You know, on the Iranian side, referring to the U.S. as the great Satan, and on the U.S. part, you know, referring to them as the mad mullahs, and so forth. And this has really set in motion the wheels for a politics of animosity that, as you pointed out, even you know, a pandemic of this proportion, unfortunately, has not been able to convince the two sides to sort of abandon their established positions and try to, you know, come to some understanding. I would say, you know, we are really dealing with four decades of psychological scar tissue in this relationship.
There's no doubt about that. And yeah, of course, the Enghilab, the revolution, and the implications of that for the last 40 years. But when you look at the dissonance between the reaction to, say, the Bam earthquake and to this point, 17 years later, what has happened in that interim period?
Right. I think, you know, what we saw was in the early, you know, 2000 era, when you had President Khatami in Iran and President, you know, Clinton in power, we saw, you know, a move toward some improvement of their ties, right? And of course, with President Obama in office, again, a same type of outreach, but one that was particularly centered around the nuclear portfolio and not necessarily much else. But, you know, I say, you know, the one of the problems, I think, in this relationship is that the clocks have not been in sync, meaning that when you had people, you know, in power in one country that were willing to necessarily negotiate with the other side, there was no willing partner on the other side. And, you know, we have had to deal with this scenario for decades. And a case in point, again, is currently, right, when President Trump came to office, of course, he has sort of established his domestic and foreign policy to be the exact opposite of what Obama had tried to, you know, accomplish.
Right.
And surely JCPOA was one of the chief, if not the main, foreign policy accomplishment of the Obama administration. So when President Trump started referring to it as the worst deal ever, you could see where we were going, you know, in that regard, regardless of what Mr. Rouhani in Iran was willing to do. So unfortunately, that's where we find ourselves at this point, right?
Right.
Politicians have their own set of preferences. There is domestic constituencies to deal with. And I would say, you know, in the tragic case of U.S.-Iranian relations, not only you have geostrategical differences between the two sides, but also this type of, you know, personality clashes that have made the situation that much more difficult.
And when you talk about personality clashes, you might say, not to be too crude about it, but if President Trump is willing to cut New York State loose, he's certainly willing to cut Iran loose in terms of any direct aid or collective response. There's so much to talk about there, but that isn't the specific focus of why we brought you on. I mean, both countries have been hit hard by the pandemic. There's no letdown in the hostile military posturing in the region. I'm interested in the storm raging in the teacup of the Iranian political diaspora, because we can be, as I'm sure you know, very divided against each other. I mean, the sheer scale of insults and vilifications and blood libel saturating the Farsi cyberspace is very high, even by Iranian standards. You seem like a voice that may be able to give us some perspective on both or all sides. What factors have brought us to this kind of point of balkanization?
Sure. You know, the British philosopher Thomas Hobbes has a very interesting sentence. He says, mathematics unites men, politics divides them. And I think that's truly the case. Because, you know, when we are dealing with politics, of course, we are dealing with the realm of subjective understandings, emotions, you know, people preferences, ideological blankets or glasses that people put on, and all sorts of things. So it is the nature of politics for people to have, you know, different views. In the case of the Iranian diaspora, again, you know, when we look back we will see that the seeds for this type of rift and cleavage really existed from the get-go, right? In other words, you had cleavages at first between those who had migrated to the West versus those who found themselves here or in Europe as refugees. So that was one of the earlier, you know, type of cleavages between the two, with the assumption that those who had migrated, of course, were benefiting or were enjoying a better standard of living than those who were fleeing the country, either because of the revolution, Iran-Iraq war, or you name it. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, politically speaking, we had other differences. In other words, of course, in places like, you know, Los Angeles in California, with a large concentration of, you know, Iranian expatriates, we saw the manifestation of this type of rifts greatly, in the sense that you had really three major camps emerge after the 79 revolution. You know, the monarchist who looked to the pre-revolutionary Iran as, you know, with a sense of nostalgia about what Iran was or could have been. And, you know, they, of course, had to, you know, point the finger at those who were, you know, considered responsible for what had transpired in 78, 79.
Right.
You had the Islamists who had just come to power after many, many years of being on the sidelines. And, of course, you know, they felt that they were on a very just cause, and their favorite slogans and so forth have to do with the subservience of the Shah's regime toward the United States, the 1953 coup, and, you know, issues of that sort. And therefore, you know, they had their rhetorical weapons all loaded and ready to go as well. And then, you know, in between, you had smaller camps of nationalists as well as, you know, leftist forces of various persuasion in the Iranian diaspora, which, you know, gradually, I think, were overtaken by the course of events in Iran, right? So there was a lot of things that was happening inside Iran that I think left its indelible mark on these internal episodes of infighting among the expat, you know, community right now. As things evolved, and as the Islamic Republic consolidated itself, you know, a bit more, and didn't really have the type of existential angst that it was experiencing in the early days of the revolution, certainly, you know, the government tried to find, you know, people outside Iran who could, you know, promote its message, if not necessarily as full-fledged, you know, lobbyists, as people who were sympathetic, right, to the cause and the message of the Islamic Republic. And I think this too contributed to the rift that we are, you know, witnessing right now. And then I think the other factor that has really been supremely important, but maybe on the background, has been the impact of sanctions. So with the sanctions policy, unfortunately, contrary to what was being said, you know, in the early days when these things were introduced, that, you know, we can have something called smart sanctions that will only be impacting a particular group of people. In reality, we realized that this really was not the case, that sanctions ended up being quite imposed in a rather blanket, you know, fashion. And therefore, you know, your grandmother or my grandmother could also be impacted by it just in the bazaar, right? Mm-hmm. By the price of, you know, buying a refrigerator, let's say, which had nothing to do with politics and yet was impregnated with this politics of animosity and the sanctions regime that, you know, had come into play. As such, and as we had decades after decades of this type of, you know, policies, something happened in the sense that the American political establishment felt that sanctioning Iran, which they viewed as their chief geostrategic rival in the region, right, was the best course of action, because regime change was certainly not a possibility, realistically speaking, or you had to pay a heavy price. In other words, if Afghanistan and Iraq gave the U.S., you know, a hiccup of sorts, going to Iran and doing the same type of thing, in my view, will be a cause for massive indigestion, okay? And therefore, I don't think that was ever part of the game, and therefore, sanctions were considered as the most suitable politically acceptable substitute.
But why have sanctions? You've sort of answered this, but why would sanctions in particular divide our own community more?
Well, I think it divides because, you know, again, as this economic situation in Iran deteriorated, the mindset that, you know, successive U.S. administrations subscribe to, and I think, frankly, part of the Iranian diaspora has bought into, was this, that, okay, if you are not going to have boots on the ground, sanctions is the best remedy,
right,
because it is going to make the Iranian regime fragile and weak and therefore susceptible to change because the people are going to rise up and bring about the change, right?
But this is starving the people. This is madness. We shouldn't be sanctioning the sanctions. But let me try this out on you. Do you think, you know, because in part of the, I have to tell you, the impetus for developing this show, a show in English aimed at the Iranian diaspora, is the sheer growth of the diaspora. You know, 40 years ago, this would have been a quaint little program. You know, oh, that's cute, the Iranian diaspora. But as you know, the numbers have grown by the millions, especially in the last mm-hmm. 2 decades. And it feels like, I mean, my main experience is in Toronto and New York, but it feels like the, as Iranians have migrated from Iran in bigger numbers, the divisions from Iran have also migrated or have amplified. Does that resonate for you? Do you think that's true?
Absolutely. I think, you know, politics is something like, you know, your backpack, right? It travels with you. It comes with you. And surely, you know, the fact that, as you pointed out, this massive number of people who have left Iran after 79, first, you know, because of the revolution and the Iran-Iraq war, and then as we saw, for example, after the Green Movement of 2009, and then, you know, more recently, it has come in various, you know, waves. And historically speaking, this is really one of the largest ever migrations that we have seen in Iran's long, long history.
Yes.
Okay. And therefore, the numbers have gone up dramatically. Remember, this was also the migration of the cream of the crop. This was sort of the best and the brightest, right? The ones who had the educational or the business skills and so forth, who were leaving the, you know, the country. You know, so put yourself, for example, in the position of a bright 22-year-old or a 24-year-old who has just gotten his BA degree or MA degree, let's say in electrical engineering, whatever, and would face the following scenario that, you know, you cannot find a decent job, you cannot find the decent laboratory that you want to do for your, you know, scientific research. Economic difficulties are such that you cannot, you know, afford to marry and, you know, live independently with your wife or husband, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, when you face these type of scenarios and you ask yourself, well, you know, I did uphold my part of the bargain. I did what I was supposed to do. Where is the government or the regime's responsibility in terms of, you know, providing X, Y, and Z for me? And if those things are not there, certainly you're going to be pointing the finger, right? Somebody is accountable for why, you know, you have this type of situation. And that person, let's say, decides to come out of the country, they leave Iran, they come to a Western setting where there are already established expatriate communities, where the message from them 24/7 is nothing but, you know, how the mullahs are, you know, responsible for every problem, you know, in the country, and they should not be getting an iota of credit regarding anything. And so we end up with scenarios where you have TV and radio stations that are really sort of ideological mouthpieces for this group or that group, and they're not performing the function that one was expecting, i.e. of giving sort of the objective news and, you know, letting the people draw their own conclusions.
Do those ideologies and thereby those divisions then easily or seamlessly get passed through the generations? In other words, I mean, that community you're talking about in Los Angeles, for example, that's not new. They've been there for decades, right? So are we to expect then that the second and third generation diaspora just continues the same divisions? And if so, why? I mean, why don't we grow out of it?
No, I don't think we are necessarily condemned to do this. Look, I mean, even today, if you compare, you know, the quality of discourse, you know, again, presented in the various TV channels that you get from LA with what you're seeing in places like London and so forth, you see a, you know, huge difference. I don't think we are condemned to, you know, relive this thing. The fact is that my children and your children who are, you know, sort of born and brought up here, they are not necessarily going to look at Iran through the same lens of somebody who had to flee Iran at a moment's notice, right, in the early 80s or at the time of the revolution. I think this second generation, third generation, it starts to see things from their own lens and not necessarily through the prism or the eyes of their parents, right? So their appreciation or perhaps even a moral attachment to their country of origin is going to be a bit different. Mm. So I'm not, you know, pessimistic in the sense of saying, well, this rift is going to stay in perpetuity and, you know, we need to live with it. I think really the time has come, especially as sort of my generation starts to pass from the scene, right, and the younger ones are taking over, to really have much more sort of optimistic, much more creative, less accusatory tone, right, in terms of what we can do as this community becomes more financially capable, as they settle down, as they think about, all right, if I have a debt of gratitude or obligation to my country of origin, you know, how can I be providing it in perhaps in ways that might indeed be helping the citizenry, but not necessarily, you know, a government that I don't necessarily, you know, accept. I think those things become possible, you know, gradually after we pass from the inflated, right, a state of rhetoric and animosity that we are experiencing right now. I don't really see the current situation as too promising or frankly productive.
What about the way others see us, and what impact does that have? Because besides the infighting in our own community, the community has been under attack from anti-Iranian sentiments rising in some countries, including the United States. You spoke to Al Jazeera in an article about the onset of Iranophobia in some circles in January of this year. And I was thinking about, you know, Professor Neda Makhbouleh does an amazing job of chronicling the way the Iranian-American community has been seen in recent decades in her book, The Limits of Whiteness. And if I can remember correctly, she talks about how, you know, pre-1979, pre-Enghalab, it's sort of, you know, it's pretty much irrelevant. There's a positive image for those who even know what Iranians are. Then it becomes extremely negative post-revolution, the hostage crisis, etc. And then there's another uptick in negativity, a massive uptick in negativity after 9/11, ironically, of course, because Iran didn't have much to do with 9/11, you might argue. But are we seeing that kind of period again? And that would seem paradoxical, because one of the beautiful things that's happened, for example, in Canada in recent months was the reaction to the desperate loss of lives in the shooting of a plane 752, where Canadians really rose and said, these are, you know, these Iranian Canadians are Canadians and we see them as ourselves. And that was very heartwarming for some of us who've been here for many years. So which one is it? What kind of period are we in now?
Right. I think you raise a really very important point. Look, as you mentioned in the introduction, the subtitle of my first book had the word nativism in it. And, you know, this is really a mindset which I would say the Iranians and the Americans share a lot of, meaning this notion that things that are homegrown and domestic, indigenous, are better than, you know, what comes from outside is foreign, you know, to us, etc. So nativism in the Iranian political context, as I describe in that book, really became, in my view, the plumb ideology that set in motion the wheels of the revolution as intellectuals started to talk about, you know, return to oneself and restoxification or Gharb Zadegi, etc. I think with the coming to power of, you know, President Trump here, we are seeing the same type of thing, right? This is the return of a nativist, you know, sentiment, that sort of the America first type of notion that, whether we like it or not, I'm afraid, considers those of us with strange sounding names, accents, black hairs, and what have you, right, as not necessarily part of that sort of, you know, circle of trust, right? That part of that fabric of this society. So there is, as you mentioned in the work of Netta, this notion of there is an exteriority assigned to us. It first had to do with the hostage crisis and the H word, and you know what the Iran's reputation, how it was damaged by that whole terrible, you know, hostage crisis. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, in politics, whether it was the hostage crisis, whether it is, you know, 9/11, whether it's the current team, these type of sentiments are strong. You know, let's forget about Iranians for a moment. Notice about the type of reaction we are beginning to see about against Chinese Americans, yes, right? Yes. This is again testimonial to the same type of sentiment. The victims might change due to the circumstances, right? To what the perceived cause, but the nature of that sentiment is there. So yes, I'm fully with you. What happened in Canada was really refreshing, reassuring. It brought our, you know, common humanity together and demonstrated that. But at the same time, as I said, unfortunately, politics has this tendency, right, to create scapegoats. Yes. And for the average citizen, often pointing the finger and blaming those who are somewhat different from the majority has been a favorite way of settling scores or clearing your conscience cheaply by saying it is not our fault. There are really these foreigners who have done this. There is a fantastic book and a documentary that I really highly recommend to your audience. It's called The Faces of Enemy by a gentleman named Sam Keen. When you watch this documentary or you read the book, you know, you really see how this politics of enmity, of how creating self and the other is really the very stuff of politics. I mean, I don't want to get philosophical about it, but even in philosophical terms, you come across the writing of a German thinker like Carl Schmitt, and he basically says, you know, let's face it, politics divides people into two groups, friends or foes, right? And it's as simple as that.
But so, what are the policy implications of that nativism, or I should say, what are the implications of policies that come from that nativism? Because with the Muslim ban and the suspension of the electronic diversity visa lottery in the United States and all the other measures put in place by the Trump administration to prevent the entry of new Iranian migrants, say, to the United States, there can be this sense that no fresh blood, you know, is being introduced to our community in the United States, and that this will have an impact over time of somehow diminishing the community. What is your take on that?
Yeah, so I'm afraid, you know, the type of things that President Trump has introduced, like the Muslim ban, etc., and, you know, making the visa requirements, all of those things that much more difficult, I think they are absolutely casebook examples of nativist, you know, sentiments. And by the way, let me add in parentheses that when you look at U.S. history, please realize that, you know, this is not something that has started with President Trump. This is a long established tradition in the U.S. You know, you go back to the 19th century, there was a movement called the Know-Nothings who were saying the same type of things. The biases against, you know, the Irish, the Italians, migrants to the U.S. again goes back more than a century. So this is a very potent ideological stream that I think President Trump has managed to tap into. And again, we see it play itself out in daily news about how he is referring to the whole coronavirus and, you know, you name it. Right. As far as whether it's going to prevent really fresh blood from coming into the country, I'm not sure. Again, it really depends on how long lasting is this going to be. Are there going to be legal challenges to this type of policies in the coming years that they've managed to be successful and therefore, you know, reverse some of these processes? At what point will, you know, we reach the sense that we realize that, okay, beyond the political rhetoric that, you know, is coming out of the White House, there are, you know, certain realities that one has to deal with. Look, you go and take a look at the data that the Department of Education puts out, right, on the number of people who earn PhDs in mathematics, let's say. in the United States. They are predominantly people who were, you know, born outside the United States.
But that's why it's counterintuitive. Sorry to interrupt you, but that's why it's counterintuitive. I mean, it may seem naive. I'm sure it'll be seen as naive for me to even ask this. But Iranian Americans are one of the most successful migrant communities. As you mentioned earlier, you know, best of the best, plenty of highly educated doctors, researchers, academics, entrepreneurs. It sure would be fair to say that Iranian Americans have always been this major source of what's called soft power for the United States, at least in the last half century. So on the face of it, you know, like, why would any U.S. administration want to deprive itself of such leverage?
Well, you know, again, it's a very good question. I would say the mindset, at least the one that you're, you know, witnessing right now, right, is not necessarily thinking in those terms. I wouldn't say it's really a smart statecraft, you know, coming out of the White House in terms of how they see these things. And, you know, there are really daily reminders. I mean, I deal with the scientific realm, right? So I am a man who looks at numbers and stats and so forth to draw my conclusions. So, as I said, the Department of Education has these annual surveys that they do of the number of people who, you know, who earn PhD degrees, etc. We have all this data available to us to know. As you pointed out, Iranian American community, along with Indian American community, are two of the most, you know, successful expatriate communities who have, you know, come here and settled down and contributed massively to the betterment of the state of knowledge, etc., in this country. Indeed, there is a gentleman who, in California, I forgot his name, but he is doing this fantastic work about, you know, putting out data on exactly what has been the contribution of Iranian doctors, lawyers, and so forth in various realms of life. You see, part of the problem that I see, frankly, here is that, and you know, we are beginning to change this thing again as this sort of second generation learns the ropes and becomes more, you know, adept in learning the politics of, you know, lobbying, creating NGOs and the like. Even though we have this massive human capital on the part of the Iranian American community, I am afraid we have not had those institutional representations or representatives who have really been effective mouthpieces, right? For this type of thing. Sure, we have, you know, groups like PAYA and others out there who are trying to do, you know, some of these things. But there is really massive amount of work to be done. I live in Washington, D.C., right? This is the land for, you know, lobbies and interest groups and so forth. And, you know, you look at any community, be it the Arab community, the Chinese, Koreans, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Everybody has their own sort of effective interest groups that are, you know, advocating for them. We need to embrace this politics of advocacy. You see, I think the mindset on the part of many in the Iranian diaspora for many years was that, you know, our suitcases are ready. We want to go back to Iran when this regime changes.
Well, the exilic mindset. But
those situations, you know, it's just a, you know, a pipe dream, right? It's not happening. So we need to put down those suitcases. We need to realize that we are here. We are developing roots. And if you allow me, I say this as a parenthetical note. Back in 2000, which was the last time I went to Iran, there was a conference where they invited me that the subject of conversation was dialogue with expatriate Iranians. And, you know, many of the Iranian political dignitaries were sitting in the room. Of course, this is during the time of President Khatami, where he was talking about dialogue of civilization. So I read a very critical paper in that conference. And I said, listen, you guys are talking about this ambitious thing about dialogue of civilization. Can you be a bit more modest and start with a smaller dialogue? And that dialogue is with the Iranian expatriate community. If you manage to do that, if you manage to succeed in that, then you can graduate to the higher level of trying to, you know, have a dialogue of civilization. And I said, listen, you are not doing that. You are not, you know, if I am somebody who left Iran and nowadays I have an 18-year-old son, what are you going to do in terms of, you know, a military service exemption for my kid? You are going to tell me that my wife has to come and put on the chador in Iran. Ain't happening, right? You want me to come and bring my money and invest in the country, but you're not going to give me any type of guarantee regarding the security of my investment. So I said, you are engaging in nothing but ta'aruf, right? This is this is just pleasantries.
Right.
And unfortunately, you know, when we compare governments such as, let's say, the one in China or in India, how they have managed to lure back many of their best and brightest, right? China, believe it or not, the investment that the Chinese expatriates are making in China is the largest in the world, right? India, same type of thing. You know, they have gone and done it. Why? Because they had governments that were farsighted enough, intelligent enough, that they said, okay,
they're welcoming
human capital that we have.
Right.
Absolutely. But we don't see it.
But Dr. Moradjerdi, there are some high-profile Iranians who you, I'm sure you know, who are vocal advocates of a severance between the United States and Iran. No green cards, no entry, no cooperation between the countries. Do you find that surprising?
I frankly do find that surprising. And let me say this. Again, unfortunately, living in Washington too, and you know, having been involved in discussion with U.S. government for the last four decades, yes, I see this. Unfortunately, it has become a situation where people who, you know, you would expect better off, right? Whether they are journalists or, you know, public intellectuals, etc. And unfortunately, everybody has taken on this role of being for or against. And I'm afraid we are shortchanging ourselves. You know, somebody asked me the other day, can you name a few, you know, people who are objective enough for some analysis on Iran without necessarily being, you know, pro or anti regime.
And could you?
Had a hard time coming up with names. Right? So, I mean, that, I think that's a tragedy. I'm laughing at it, but really, it's a tragic thing because, you know, the nature of this relationship is so complex. It's so nuanced. That, you know, reducing it to a bunch of slogans, right? I don't think is really going to do anyone any service. I mentioned something about my latest book that you were kind enough to mention,
yes.
This post-revolutionary Iran book. You know, the reason I did this book might be interesting for your audience, and that is the following. You know, I realized, again, having come here and having talked to various folks in the State Department, Defense Department, etc., for the last, you know, three decades or so, I realized that their knowledge of Iran in so many ways is really just surface deep, right? They know about a few leading personalities, mm-hmm. but when you ask them more substantial questions, and I did this in one session where I asked, you know, the audience, I said, can you guys talk intelligently for 5 minutes to me about, you know, what do you think is the collective profile of somebody who becomes a mayor, a governor in Iran? And, you know, there was this strange silence in the room because, you know, nobody really had done any type of empirical study. So I said, okay, I'm going to go and reinvent the wheel. So I wrote this book, which puts together the biographies of 2,300 yes. Iranian politicians from day one of the revolution up to now. Why? Because I wanted, for the first time, to move away from this sort of journalistic narrative on Iran and provide hard data on, you know, this many members of the Iranian political elite so that a bright PhD student can go and do some fascinating empirical research about who these people are in addition to the, you know, 100 tables and so forth that I have assembled in the book so that we have a better understanding of who these people are, why is it that they do what they do, etc. But you know, again, unfortunately, we have taken the easy way out. It's the dominance of, you know, rhetorics and slogans and finger pointing rather than more in-depth analysis.
Can I just say you're modest when you say you've written a book. That's not just a book. That's a blueprint of this kind of information and correctly lauded by so many people in academic circles and the diaspora. Again, that book is for people listening, Post-Revolutionary Iran, a Political Handbook, that came out in 2018. You know, this whole conversation, I asked these questions and I have one foot in a camp as well, kind of saying, should we be cutting our own community a bit of slack? Because we live in an age of populism and extreme polarization everywhere in the mm-hmm. world, right? I think of Brexit sure. in the UK. I think of the extreme divisions in France right now. I think of the obvious sure. polarization in the United States. Could it be that the Iranian global community is basically reflecting the same radical polarization of every other community?
No, that's absolutely true. I mean, you know, I don't think the Iranians are any exception. You know, they can be impacted by the same dynamics and wave of thinking that, you know, we see in other places. Look, you know, notice, for example, you know, again, forget for a moment Iran. Look what happened when the issue of Syrian refugees came up, right? And what was the reaction in so many European capitals
yes.
to whether they should be opening their doors to accepting these folks or not? Right. So populism, nativism, etc., these things are on the rise. This is a universal phenomena. And it's a very powerful and potent way of thinking that we should certainly be taking it seriously. And yet, when we are speaking of this Iranian diaspora, I think, you know, I hope that we take into account the fact that, again, these are highly educated people, highly skilled people, you know, who have had the luxury of living in some of the freest countries in the world, seeing the shortcomings of how things were back home and how things are here. In other words, I think we can be effective interlocutors in the sense that we understand, you know, these two cultures, right? And therefore, when an Iranian simplifies or oversimplifies or engages in generalizations about what America is all about or Americans are like, you know, we should stop them with the same type of intensity that when an American,
yes,
again,
yes.
Passes judgment
yes.
on our compatriots.
That's true. And, you know, getting back to that Iranian-American community, or even the global Iranian diaspora, there's a sad element to this, where there still seems to be a discomfort with our own identity in parts of the community. So, for example, in 2010, this isn't that long ago, in a U.S. census in California, only a fraction of the Iranian-American community identified themselves as being of Iranian descent at all. Others chose mm-hmm. to identify as, say, Armenian or Turk or some other ethnicity. Also, there are many Iranians living in the States or elsewhere who describe themselves as Persians, something I remember as a kid after the revolution here in Canada that my parents would say, you know, to kind of as if to trying to avoid the guilt or externally imposed shame of being Iranian somehow. You know, are you
right.
disheartened that these patterns continue?
Yes, but also as a social scientist, I also understand, you know, what is at play here. Look, there is absolutely a psychological need, right, for acculturation on the part of many. Therefore, you know, when it comes to the census, you know, they can put on the check mark based on the white racial category and move on and, you know, do not see any need to be more specific about their background. Or, you know, as a social scientist, I understand that in Iran, you know, unfortunately, both before and after the revolution, we have not been able to properly address the notion of the various ethnicities that exist in Iran and, you know, thinking of them as part and parcel of a bigger whole, right, a bigger group. And therefore, it is natural that, as we see inside Iran itself, manifestation of these type of ethnic demands being, you know, voiced in stadiums and the like these days. So this is all understandable. But I also want to make another point. You see, an Indian thinker said something about identity that I really has sort of captivated me for many decades now. His argument was that identity is like archaeological layers, right? There is one layer on top of the other. So if you want to understand who I am as a person or who you are, really what we need to do is we need to scratch the surface, or better yet, we need to pick up a pair of scissors and make a cut, right? When you make that cut, you realize that what makes any person who they are sort of a multiplicity of identities, right? You know, whether they are, what is their job, you know, what city they come from, what is their, you know, ethnic background, what is their ideological, you know, standpoint, are they a husband, wife, et cetera, et cetera. And it's really when we have this mental map, right? A much more holistic understanding of what a person is that makes up our identity. I think part of what I see as the challenge facing the Iranian diaspora right now is really the need for some more profound reflections on what are these layers of identity for us, and how comfortable are we to be there? There is no reason to, you know, want to insist on being a one-dimensional being. Why? Right? Why can I not be sort of a hyphenated American, okay? And consider that hyphen as actually a badge of honor, as something that gives me an interesting vantage point to be a bit different, to look at things with sort of more of a critical eye, okay? So remember that one reason in any society intellectuals are so important, it's because these are the folks who can stand on the sidelines and take a look, a critical look at what is happening on a day-to-day basis, right, and try to theorize what it is that we are doing subconsciously and not necessarily aware of. I think this is the same type of thing that we need to do here. We need this second generation, third generation, that is a bit, you know, separate from the trauma of 79 and what happened, the warriors, et cetera, et cetera, and really can go about in a more objective way thinking about this. I will add this one. You know about this Camp Ayande, right? For these younger kids, Iranian Americans who go there. I sent my son to this camp some years ago when he was a teenager. And I can't tell you what a profound impact this had on him. If before that, before going to this camp for young Iranian American kids, you know, if I wanted to encourage him to, you know, learn more about Iranian history, etc., it was an uphill battle. Mm-hmm. He goes there, thanks to peer pressure or the impact, etc. He comes back and starts asking me all these, you know, interesting questions. Tell me more about what is Zoroastrianism all about, right? I mean, these were the type of things that, you know, had changed inside of him. Mm-hmm. So as a father, but also as a social scientist, you know, I realized, okay, something really is interesting happened. You know, my son, and I'm sure there are many like him, are responding not necessarily to our inflated rhetoric, right, about yes, nationalism and yes, patriotism and yes, so forth, but he's seeing people of his own kind, yes, okay, born yes, and bred, you know, here in the U.S., and yet there is something that is like an umbilical cord, right,
yes,
that ties them to that country of origin.
Well, I'm an example of that. I'm an example of that. I've grown up entirely outside of Iran, but I feel that umbilical cord. And also, you know, I think that we often maybe make the mistake of thinking that our unity needs to come through politics, or ideological unity, and in fact that the cultural ties run very deep. Whether it's simple things like the way we interact with our families, or cuisine, or our social culture, you know, and those are the things that you start to discover. I say this as someone who grew up as a kid in the 80s and hit my teens in the 80s and went deeply into the ethnic closet, you know, not wanting to say I was Iranian because it was scary. There were no other Iranians around. People just thought, oh, terrorists, hostage crisis. And it wasn't until I came out of my teens and was in university in the 1990s where I thought, wait a minute, there's nothing wrong with being Iranian. In fact, I love being Iranian. Yeah. I've had this imposed on me externally. So what saddens me is when the divisive political discourse prevents us from being able to come together culturally.
Yeah, but you know, I think you said something really profound here. Look, political change, right, is contrary to what people might think, is much, much easier than cultural change. And thanks God for that, right? In other words, you can change a regime through a coup, a revolution, you know, voting, whatever. That's easy done. But it is really hard to change the culture of a country or a community. It's like, you know, you have to introduce change with eye drops, right? It's going to be incremental. It's going to be a slow, gradual, and so forth and so on. So I think what we have going for us, as you were pointing out, is that there is truly a very rich culture, a very rich language, you know, literary tradition, etc., that can be the building block for this generation that can take pride in their place of origin, etc. So their Iranian-ness can be something that, again, hopefully once we pass these polarizing time that we are living through, you know, right now, I think it's something that is going to be a fantastic cultural reservoir that people can tap into, right? And how fortunate are these folks who are, you know, living in diaspora, in the sense that, you know, whatever country that they are living in or they were born in, right, has given them something, and their country of their birth or the country of their parents' birth, etc., can provide another cultural, you know, capital for them to tap into as well. You know, it can enrich us in so many ways. When I see my kids switching from English to Persian, when they do not want others to understand what it is that they are saying, you know, I say, God, you know, these guys are well equipped, right, to deal with so many situations that they might be encountering.
I love that you you went there in terms of as we end this off, because that's exactly where I wanted to go in terms of before I let you go, asking you a question on a more personal level. This has been such a difficult year for Iran, for people of Iranian descent. Think of the brutal crackdown on protesters in the fall. Think of the near war with the United States, the shooting of Flight 752, the COVID crisis. Where is your heart these days as not just another one of us in the Iranian diaspora, but as the guy who literally has written the book on post-revolutionary Iran? And talk about those seeds of hope that you see for the global Iranian community.
I came to the States when I was 16 years old. And so in a way, I would say my formative years were spent in Iran. And therefore, it's really hard for me to divorce myself from what happens there. Again, you know, before checking CNN in the morning when I wake up, I automatically, my hand goes for the BBC, you know, Persian side, because I want to know what's the latest news in Iran. And then I switch to see what CNN has to, you know, say about current events. So I think that's a fact. And yes, unfortunately, we have had these terrible events. Frankly, I think, you know, in Iran, we are dealing with a situation where we have a regime that is truly not representative of its citizenry, and the people certainly deserve much better than what the Islamic Republic has been able to, you know, to give to them. But as I said, I for one do not embrace this you know, policy of sanctions and so forth, because of the collective damage that I think it does for the ordinary citizens. So I think it is part of my moral compass that I need to maintain a degree of distance from whatever government, from whatever media outlets, etc., that is out there, because I want to be able to speak my mind as I see fit, be it, you know, the American political establishment, the Iranian political establishment. It doesn't make a difference. I think people like me who are social scientists or are, you know, public intellectuals of a sort, you know, we have sort of have this obligation to be there. You know, Jean-Paul Sartre had something really fascinating to say about the role of intellectuals that I mentioned in one of my books. He said, you know, the role of an intellectual is like that small piece of, you know, a stone that gets caught in your shoes, right? You know how it bothers you, that piece there?
Yes.
The role of an intellectual should be the same thing, right? You should be able to tickle a society's conscience. You should be able to push them, push the envelope on them, you know, on how they're clearing their conscience cheaply, or how they are resorting to stereotypes, simplistic narratives of how things are. That's the role I think we need to be, you know, playing. And again, in terms of the diaspora, I think this is fantastic, because this is a community that has two streams of water, right, coming into this big ocean. So with that, I would say we have the opportunity to take that critical distance and be able to hold our politicians, intellectuals, etc., accountable for the type of narrative that they put out, and challenge them when needed, so that we can elevate the level of, you know, thinking and discourse in our respective community.
It's truly a pleasure to get to talk to you. Thank you so much for doing this today.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Dr. Mehrzad Borujerdi, Director of Virginia Tech School of Public and International Affairs, his latest book, Post-Revolutionary Iran, A Political Handbook, he joined us from Virginia today. Well, that was, I could talk to him for hours. Dr. Borujerdi. He does an amazing job, really. It's hard to stay balanced and opine about our diaspora. Shaya and Reza have been listening in.
Yeah.
How about that, huh?
He's extraordinary.
Yeah.
To be honest, it was so insightful.
Shaya, I can't really hear Reza. Can you?
Can you hear me?
That's better.
Yes.
I don't know if just making sure the humans can hear you.
You got it, because I'm talking to the microphone.
He was insightful.
Right now, he was very insightful. I mean, it's amazing.
To say the least.
I know.
All right. So I have the letters. By the way, we were supposed to bring Sara in, but you're still, you haven't budged. Well, I know you were.
I'm having I was so engaged with the conversation.
Right. So let me explain to people. So we have this space and we're recording here, but Sara is in our larger space, but can't get too close to the studio because we're trying to observe social distancing. So everybody's
that's
in their
right.
own place and we can't get her close to a microphone, but she's. So I was thinking for letters of the day, at least we would get her voice. We can call her. Do you want to call her?
Yeah, let's call her because I'm not leaving the studio. So it's 6.
There's Shia's call right on it. Look at that.
There we go.
Almost like it was prescribed.
There we go. Yeah. Oh my God. I should be like, why are you calling me?
Hello?
Sara? Hello?
Salam, Salam.
Hi. It's us in the other room. Chetori.
Merci, khubi.
So Sara does all of our response to some of the stuff on YouTube. Merci, Sarajan, for all your work.
Khaish mikonam. I'm working on social media.
I know.
Merci, Harud.
I know.
Sara.
But I think mikonam ke Reza chan is off me hot.
She's.
What? What's she saying? So, Reza chi? Let me just explain. Sara is wondering why Reza occupies the studio and Sara doesn't come in. Next, for sure. Then we'll keep switching it up. Anyway, merci, Sara. I'm going to do letters of the week. We're going to do that. Okay. Do you want to stick on the line while I do it? Hello?
Hello?
Oh, do you want to stay on the line while we do the letters? She's like, well, why
yeah, she picked them herself.
Okay, so Kaveh Ansari. So our episode 5 of Rukh was featuring Sona Sotoudeh, the amazing classical piano player from Vancouver. Kaveh Ansari left us a message on YouTube. He says, thank you for this interview. I wish the best for Sonaz, although I'm not so sure the struggling culture of Iran can be saved from thousands of miles away. So this is a reference to the fact that Sonaz was saying she hopes through music she can help to restore, rehabilitate, and celebrate the culture of Iran. Thank you for that opinion, Kaveh. This from Marlene Shapkuri. On Instagram, about the same episode, episode 5. Sonaz is a class in her own. Thanks for bringing a world-class pianist into my world in rural Canada. Rukh Media accomplished that for me. Thanks. Thank you very much for that, Marlene. This from Turaj Yousefi. Hello, Gian. Thanks for the great interviews. I think within a year you can speak Farsi fluently.
and probably
ما باشیم حسابی فارسی صحبت میکنیم.
ببین منم فکر میکنم الان فلوئنتم، یعنی چی یه سال دیگه فلوئنت میشی؟
debatable.
And probably you can have the Farsi version of Rook as well. Okay, well that's true. I probably couldn't do the Dr. Burjardi interview.
Okay, fill the blank.
Shai, did I say something wrong again?
Okay, fill the blank. امیدوارم که روز خوبی
هستین. Thank you for that, Turaj Yusefi. ولی من فکر کنم اگه با من حرف بزنی پیدا میکنی که میتونم حالا fluently دیگه زیاده ولی see the problem is I start speaking Farsi and you guys immediately start laughing. It's not helpful.
It's really cute.
Yeah, that's okay. It's cute. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
It's cute.
Thanks, Sarah. And with the letter of the week, Negin Dusti Alavi. Thank you, Gia. So this was on Instagram about episode number 6, which was Arshid Azarin, who is a doctor in Paris on the front lines working with the COVID-19 situation, got COVID-19 himself, became infected, recovered, went straight back to the front lines. He's also an incredible piano player. Sarah, I know you were a big fan of him, right? And that
yes.
interview, yeah. He's pretty inspirational. Thank you, Sarah. That's all. I thought you were going to say something about Arshid Azarin.
I was waiting for you. But
I was waiting for you to continue. Well, I'm asking you what you thought of Arshid Azarin. Yeah, he's amazing. So Negin Dusti Alavi on Instagram says, thank you, Gian and team. It was wonderful to hear about Dr. Azarin's journey and his great accomplishments in both realms of medicine and music. Negin says, in my opinion, what a good doctor and a good musician have in common is their unique ability to be present in the moment, to detect subtleties, and to merge their repertoire of knowledge and perceptions in order to connect with people at a personal level. Insightful and very well said. Negin, you have our letter of the week.
من right. خیلی خوشحالم که از چند سال پیش کار پیانو آقای آذرین رو دنبال میکردم و وقتی که توی این برنامه ایشون رو دیدم خیلی خوشحالتر شدم. فقط من اینو بعد میگفتم که نگفتم.
مرسی. Thank you, Sara. Thank you for that. And thanks to Shaya and Reza. Info@rookmedia.com is a way to reach us or post on any of our platforms.
زیر پاف تدان دلی که بهر تو ندرزد شرح این عاشقی ننشیند در سخن که بحر عشق والای تو همه جهان نیرزد
Going out on a song called Iran, Iran. That's Mohammed Nouri, a piece composed by Mohammed Sarir. This is Full Time for Rook today. Thank you to our amazing little team that puts this together each week. Back on Monday for Bollywood to Hollywood and the Iranian diaspora. I'm Gian Gomeshi. Mizun Bashi.
جان من میمانی ای وطن به زیر پاف تدان دلی که بهر تو نلرزد شرح این عاشقی ننشیند در سخن که بهر عشق والای تو همه جهان نیرزد ای ایران ایران دور از دامان پاکت دست دگران بدگوهران ای عشق سوزان ای شیرین ترین رویای من تو بمان در دل و جان ای ایران ایران گلزار سبز دور از تاراج خزان جور زمان ای مهر رخشان ای روشنگر دنیای من به جهان تو بمان صد چمن سرخی خون من سپیدی طلوع سحر به پرچمت نشسته شرح این عاشقی ننشیند در سخن به من که تا ابد هستیم به هستی تو بسته ای ایران ایران دور از دامان پاکت دست دگران بدگوهران ای عشق سوزان ای شیرین ترین رویای من تو بمان در دل و جان ای ایران ایران گلزار سبز دور از تاراج خزان جور زمان ای مهر رخشان ای روشنگر دنیای من به جهان بمان در روح و جان من میمانی ای وطن به زیر پاف تدان دلی که بهر تو نلرزد شرح این عاشقی ننشیند در سخن که بهر عشق والای تو همه جهان نیرزد.